Hello, good morning children. How are you all? Today in this video I'm going to explain class 7 history 3rd chapter, the Delhi Sultans, part 3. Okay, so in the previous video you have learned how the sultans, they have established their kingdom, how they have built to develop their culture and language, Muslim culture, how they have built different masjids, and who were there in the masjid to perform the ritual, prayers and all those you have learned. Now, let's see the ecclesiastic administration and consolidation under the Khaljis and Tughlaqs. And that means here, under the Khalji dynasty, Khalji kingdom kings and the Tughlaq dynasty kings, how they have done their administration, how they have ruled the kingdoms. Now, you are going to learn in this video. Okay, now see. The consolidation of a kingdom as vast as the Delhi Sultanate needed reliable governors and administrators. So, here administration dependent upon governors only. Because one sultan from the capital city, he can't manage all those things. Capital city. So, he appointed some governors in different places. With the help of these governors, Sultan used to administer the kingdom. So, here these governors, reliable governors, trusted governors are needed to Sultan. Governors and administrators needed, Sultanate, Delhi Sultanate needed reliable governors and administrators. Rather than appointing aristocrats and landed chieftains as governors, the early Delhi sultans, especially Iltutmish, Rajya Sultana's father, what he has done, favored their special slaves purchased for military service called Bandagan in Persian. So, remaining all the kings, what they have done, their relatives are from noble families, they have appointed as governors and administrators, chieftains and all those. But it is not that good that believing all these people. Because whenever if there is weakness of, if they know the weakness of the Sultan, what they use it to do? They go against the kings. So, Sultan Iltutmish, what he has done? He has purchased some slaves. Okay, slaves. Purchased for military service. For military service, for army service, he has purchased. That means he bought some slaves. Slaves means human labor without salary. Okay, those people. Okay, so these slaves, okay, they were called Bandagan. These slaves were called as Bandagan in Persian language. What was the name of those slaves? Bandagan. In which language? Persian language. In Persian language, slaves were called as Bandagan. Okay. So, what he has done with these Bandagans, let's see. They were carefully trained to man some of the most important political offices in the kingdom. So, he has given training to these Bandagans. He has given. Who? Sultan Iltutmish. King Iltutmish gave training to these Bandagans in office work. Okay. In political offices, he has given training. Since they were totally dependent upon their master, the Sultan could trust and rely upon them. Here, these slaves, they don't have family. Of course, if family also, they are slaves. So, they don't have the desire to occupy the kingdom or something. They don't revolt. So, what he has done, he has given training to them and he can believe them truly. Who? Sultan Iltutmish. Slaves rather than sons. Here one manuscript was there about these slaves. I will read out. Let's see, children. The sultans were advised. A slave whom one has brought up and promoted must be looked after, for it needs a whole lifetime and good luck to find a worthy and experienced slave. Wise men have said that A worthy and experienced slave is better than a son. We don't know even our sons when they go against and when they behave with parents. We can't trust. But the trained slave, he will do the slaves lifelong. Lifelong, they will do service to their kings. They don't have other option. That's why maybe here one saying was there. A worthy and experienced slave is better than a son. That means how trust, how much belief they got on these slaves. Okay. Can you think of any reason why a slave would be better than a son? Sons, they will know already in the Delhi Sultanate or Sultan, already in the king's stories we have learned so many times. For the desire of the kingdom, for the desire of crown, so many sons. What they have done? They have killed their fathers, other kings. So, there may be so many revolts or rival things they have done. So, here, what the kings, this saying was, that's why this saying was popular, became popular. A worthy and experienced slave is better than a son. Okay. Now, let's see. The Khaljis and Tughlaqs continued to use Bandhagan and also raised people of humble birth who were often their clients to high political positions. So what the Sultan Iltutmish done, the remaining, the successor kings also, they have approached the same process. But they have given opportunity to noble people also, who are trusted, noble people in high positions. For high positions. That means for normal office work, for administration normal office work, they used Bandhagans. And in high positions, they have appointed noble people who are the best trusted. The trusted people, the noble people, they have appointed in high positions. Who has done this? Tughlaqs and Khaljis. Okay, Tughlaqs and Khaljis. They were appointed as generals and governors. Here, high positions means governors and generals. However, this also introduced an element of political instability. But later, in the succeeding time, it became political instability. Because here, slaves in some positions and noble people were in higher positions. Okay, so often clashes arose there. So it became political, it brought political instability in those situations. Slaves and clients were loyal to their masters and patrons, but not to their heirs. Heirs means the king's sons. So these slaves, they were loyal to their kings. Who has purchased them? To him only they have shown their loyalty, but not to their heirs. Heirs means the sons, successors, next generation people. New sultans had their own servants. If any revolt or any war happened, means the new kings will come. So the people who were there in the offices, they don't know the new person. But the new kings, they brought their own servants. So there in adjustment and compromising, there often some situations, difficult situations aroused here. As a result, the accession of a new monarch often saw conflict between the old and the new nobility. Okay, so see, suppose one person, okay, suppose one king was there. Okay, suppose I will say Prithvi. Okay, Prithvi was a king. He has appointed some slaves and nobles. Okay. So, from another kingdom, Kiran was another king. He occupied, he won the war. Okay. And he occupied Prithvi's kingdom. So, here, he brought his own servants. So, often, so when he brought these new servants, what the clash will come? Here, these slaves were loyal to Prithvi only, but they were not loyal to Kiran. And he has his own servants. So, Here, these slaves and nobles and among these servants, there was always conflicts around. Was it? As a result, the accession of a new monarch often saw conflict between the old and the new nobility. The patronage of these humble people by the Delhi Sultans also shocked many elites, and the authors of Persian Tawari criticized the Delhi Sultans for appointing the low and base born to high offices. So when these conflicts often happen, the Tawariks, the people who has write those stories, king's stories, histories, they made these scribe Tawariks. Tariq or Tawarik means history writer, na? They saw it as a criticized the Delhi Sultans for appointing the low and base born. Here he has appointed the slaves, na? That's why the Tawariks, they criticized the Delhi Sultans for appointing these low based people in higher offices. Officials of Sultan Muhammad Tughlaq. Sultan Muhammad Tughlaq appointed Ajiz Kumar, a wine distiller, that means who prepares wine. Okay, that wine preparer. Who was the name? Aziz Kumar. So Muhammad Tughlaq appointed this wine distiller into a noble position. Firuz Hazam, a barber. Manka Tabak, a cook. And two gardeners, Latha and Peera, to high administrative posts. So see how what a wine distiller do? A barber, a cook and gardeners will manage these office works, official works. But Sultan Muhammad Tughlaq, what he has done, he has appointed them in a new high positions, administrative posts. Ziauddin Barani, a mid 14th century chronicler, reported their appointments as a sign of the Sultan's loss of political judgment and his incapacity to rule. So Ziauddin Barani, a chronicler who often writes the histories of the kings, he has described his action, Sultan Muhammad Tughlaq's action, as a loss of administration. That was, he was not able to rule the kingdom. Who criticized? Ziauddin Barani. Whom he criticized? Tughlaq, Muhammad Tughlaq. That means he has not that much administrative power. That's why he has appointed a barber, a cook, a wine distiller and two gardeners in high administrative posts like that. Okay. Like the earlier sultans, the Khalji and Tughlaq monarchs appointed military commanders as governors of territories of varying sizes. These lands were called Ikta. Okay. That means some part of place, that part was called as Ikta. And their holder was called Iktadar. Okay. The person who is having rights on these Iktas, they were called as Iktadar or Mukti. Iktadar or Mukti. Iktadar or Mukti. Okay. Military commanders as governors of territories. Governors of territories. Governors of territories as Ikta. Okay. Military commanders to varying sizes of places. Those places were called as Iktas. These governors and territories to Iktas are called as Iktadar or Mukti. Iktadar or Mukti. These lands were called Ikta and their holder was called Iktadar or Mukti. The duty of the Muktis was to lead military campaigns and maintain law and order in their iktas. So what was the duty of the iktidar? He has to lead the military campaigns and maintain law and order in the iktas. Okay, he has to, what was the duty of the iktidar? He has to lead military campaigns. Lead military campaigns and to manage law and order. Law and order in the iktas. Okay. In exchange for their military services, the Muktis collected the revenues of their assignments as salary. So, for this service, they used to collect in their iktas. Revenues in the iktas, and they have taken that as salaries in the iktas. Okay. That money they used to take as salaries. They also paid their soldiers from these revenues. So, from that money, what they have collected as revenue in the iktas, they have taken, and at the same time they use it to pay the soldiers also. Here military campaigns means they have to appoint army soldiers also. For those soldiers also, they use it to pay money from this iktas revenues only. Control over muktis was most effective if their office was not inheritable and if they were assigned iktas for a short period of time before being shifted. So here, if these iktidars often inheritant, okay, inheritable means if they were assigned iktas for a short period. If this post, iktidar post, was hereditary, means it was easy because from the beginning onwards they were the controllers and they used to get money revenue from this and managing. But if you are a new person as a iktidar and you were appointed for a short period only, means it was very difficult to manage this ikta because you don't have that much grip. That's why these harsh conditions of service were rigorously imposed during the reigns of Alauddin Khalji and Muhammad Tughlaq. So these hard conditions were aroused in the time of Alauddin Khalji and Muhammad Tughlaq. Accountants were appointed by the state to check the amount of revenue collected by the muktis. So here, on the revenue what they have collected from the ikta by muktis, so to check these accounts, they have appointed some more people on these muktis, because how much revenue they are getting, how much they are paying to soldiers and how much salary these people are taking, to check these they have appointed accountants also. Care was taken that the mukti collected only the taxes prescribed by the state and that he kept the required number of soldiers. So because these accountants are there, means they can collect. If the accountant was there, means these people, muktis, will collect the prescribed amount only. Otherwise, for these money deserved, they can collect more and more revenue, means administration will become difficult. That's why accountants were appointed to check the muktis actions. As the Delhi Sultans brought the hinterland of the cities under their control, they forced the landed chieftains, the Samanta aristocrats and rich landlords to accept their authority. So the hinterlands and garrison towns, when they got the power, the control of these hinterlands, and they forced the landed chieftains, the Samantas, to accept their authority. You have to come under us, like that. The Sultans forced these Samantas. Under Alauddin Khalji, the state brought the assessment and collection of land revenue under its own control. The rights of the local chieftains to levy taxes were cancelled and they were also forced to pay taxes. So after getting the Samantas into control, they cancelled their revenue powers. That means collecting taxes they have cancelled. And those chieftains, those Samantas also, they have to pay revenues to sultans. It made compulsory. The sultans' administrators measured the land and kept careful accounts. Some of the old chieftains and landowners served the Sultanate as revenue collectors and assessors. So, from those Samantas who were liable to them, who were trusted to them, so they were appointed as land chieftains and revenue collectors. There were three types of taxes on cultivation called kharas. So, on the cultivation tax was called as three types of taxes. There on cultivation, the cultivation tax was called as kharas. Okay, cultivation tax was called as kharas and amounting to about 50% of the peasant's crop. So, 50% of the crop they have to pay as kharas. 50%, that means half of the crop they have to pay. How crucial this one, see how much they are spending. Half, 50% as kharas means it is very difficult. And the second one is on cattle. And the second one is on the cattle. If you have any animals means on the cattle also you have to pay tax. And the third one is on houses, house tax. So these were the three taxes which were collected in the Delhi, Tughlaq's and Alauddin Khalji's dynasty's time. During the Sultan's times, they were collected three types. One is on the cultivation tax, second one is on the cattle, and the third one is on houses. How much they used to collect on the cultivation? 50% of the crop. 50% of the crop they have to pay as tax. So, these are the types of taxes. I hope now, children, you understood the content. The remaining part, I will explain in the next video. Thank you. Have a nice day.